Hey guys, thank you again for joining this video, and we will just move on because I know time is of the essence. Just to recap where we are still discussing that second limb, which I have renamed and which I have said in the previous video. It's now called criteria of enforcement. We are discussing still one of four of that subheading under criteria for enforcement, which is the reason for enforcing promises. The other three subheadings of criteria for enforcement would be parties to a contract, formalities, and capacity to engage into a contract. Under the subheading reason for enforcing promises, which is the common law ground, we would have discussed out of the three headings, consideration and seal. We are now discussing that final heading, which is reliance. Now, reliance is very important because it does come together with a discussion with consideration. Now, reliance usually, and it commenced and it started with representation of facts or future conduct. It is very important to understand. And where we go with reliance, and this is a statement I'll read to you, it is about enforcing a promise through estoppel, that is, preventing someone from rescinding or asserting a right contrary to what is implied by a previous statement or actions. And to explain that, I will cite the case of Hughes versus Metropolitan Railway. And I want you to understand this case. It was a lease agreement for 99 years. There was 10 years remaining. However, there was a situation of repairs. The landlord decided to write to the tenant and tell them you have 6 months per the lease agreement to remedy these repair issues. The tenant thought that he would negotiate with the landlord so that the landlord could buy the remaining 10 years of the lease. The landlord would have made a promise that he would not enforce the provision of the seeking remedy for 6 months for repairs. The negotiations broke down. The landlord then cited that the 6 months was up, even though, or including the negotiation period in which they were negotiating. And therefore, the tenant brought a claim and said, no, you can't do that. And the tenant was successful in enforcing that promise by the landlord not to continue, not to allow time to continue in terms of the 6 months to do the repairs. In fact, the 6 months then restarted at the point of the end of the failed negotiation attempt. That is an example of enforcing that promissory estoppel. It's important to understand that because in the Hughes case, it has moved along. That was based on a promise and a representation as it relates to not enforcing. Now, it's important that you understand that representation is one component of reliance. And there's a reason why I'm stressing representation. And I mentioned the case Hughes, because the courts are more inclined to have a discussion around promises rather than representation. And that's why in the Hughes case, it was important because from the Hughes case, modern law came in and said, really, okay, the law aims to protect the promise rather than the representation. So therefore, you can make a promise, but if your promise, sorry, you can make a representation, but your representation is not really what holds weight. It's if you make a promise, then that is what we are willing to consider. And that's where we have the estoppel coming in. And hence the name promissory estoppel. It's really, promissory estoppel is basically saying you are legally barred from acting contrary to your promise. That's just putting it into context. Now, what important thing I want you to understand is two things. Now, as it relates to promissory estoppel, is that there was two leading cases from Lord Denning. And in those two cases, he actually was contradictory, if I can say this respectfully about Lord Denning. But Lord Denning is, because I am English trained, I have the highest regards. I've read lots of his rulings and I hold him in high esteem and he's interesting. So in his situation, there was a case called Central London Property Trust v. High Trees. And most of us will be very accustomed to that case because it's a locus classicus case that basically attempted to say that The promissory estoppel was to be seen as a sword. Since then, Lord Denning has come in Combe versus Combe and said, no, it should be used as a shield. What we mean by that is just imagine what a sword and a shield is. You use a sword to attack, to cleave, to go forward, to thrust, to start the action. You use the shield to defend, to retreat, and to, you know, cover yourself and protect yourself. So therefore, it is important to understand that promissory estoppel is really a shield that is afforded to you. You cannot go forward and use it as a cleave. Okay, so it's important to understand that. Now, one note I want you to understand in terms of understanding promises as well is that there is a promise to vary, which is seen as a variation, and then there is a promise to waver. Now, the reason why I mention those two is because sometimes in discussion, you have to establish whether or not the promise that is being discussed, if you have moved past a representation and established that it's a promise, is it purporting to vary the contract, hence a variation, hence change the obligation, or is it purporting to waive an obligation? There is a difference, and you need to understand and show the examiner that you understand that discussion. Now, important as well is to understand that promissory estoppel started, or estoppel started as a remedy in equity. So it was an equitable remedy. It has now evolved into a common law remedy. Now, just to recap, and I'm recapping at this stage because it's important to understand that we have talked about enforcing representation at the beginning, which is as it relates to facts and future conducts. We talked about how it has developed through Hughes in terms of promissory estoppel. Then we talked about the modern approach. We talked about how the courts are now more inclined to enforce promises rather than representation. And then we talked about the fact that it can be used as a shield, not a sword, Combe versus High Trees. Now, what we're going to talk about now more in depth is promissory estoppel. Now, what it suggests is that in a promissory estoppel, we need to have requirements. And one of those requirements is that there must be a promisor and there must be a promisee. The promisor makes a promise through representation in words or conduct. You might be saying to me, wait a second, you're confusing me again. I thought we moved past representation and we're talking about promise. But how else would you make a promise? If you want to interchange it with using the word you spoke about a promise, then fine. So I'm not confusing you. What I'm saying is that the promisor is saying, rather than making a representation, if you're confused, is saying by words or conduct, this is what I'm promising. Okay? The promisee would have acted to his detriment and changed his position. That is the requirement of promissory estoppel. Or estoppel. So therefore, what you're understanding is that a promise is made by the promisor and the promisee has changed his position and acted to his detriment. Now, remembering that it can only be used as a shield, okay? Now, when we talk about the promise being made and the changing in position, there is another consideration that we must look into, which is that change in position, to renag or to recant or to go back on or to avoid that promise, if it's deemed to be unconscionable or unjust, that is where the courts start getting more involved. And that is one of the requirements you will have to demonstrate. In addition to promisor making the promise, the promisee acting to his detriment, and establishing that to recant on that promise would be unjust and unconscionable. Now, also, it is important to understand that the detriment mustn't be just that which is foreseeable. The detriment must be real. It must be actual. The detriment must be live. It must be in front of you. So the parties would have suffered because of the detriment, or the parties would have suffered some detriment, and it's real. It is cost incurred. it's a position that they have taken based on their reliance of the promise made that has affected them adversely, or maybe in some form or fashion in terms of cost incurred and that sort of thing. So therefore, what I'm saying is that the detriment must also be real. So just to recap what we just said in terms of, because I'm going through this because I want you to understand, in terms of promissory estoppel, we are talking about promisor, promisee, making the promise change of position. We talked about it could only be used as a shield, but we talked about also that you must establish that the promise that was made, to recant on it, it would be unjust and unconscionable, and also the detriment that in which the promisee would have embarked upon is real and actual. Okay? Now, some of the remedies that are available under reliance are going to be a claim for actual expenses. So therefore, if you have a situation where you may be in a situation where there is reliance and there's detriment, you know, there may be a situation where one would say, hey, you know what? We may be looking towards getting the contract enforced. You may not get the contract enforced as a remedy. You may be able to claim for that actual expenses. Remember, that actual detriment, you may be able to claim for that. You may also be able, based on your reliance, to keep a benefit if it was in fact a benefit that was derived from as a result of the reliance. And lastly, and when we get to remedies, we'll be talking about this, but there's something called expectation damages, which is forward thinking, which is very, in Canadian law, they practice expectation damages as your first default damages application. And then what if it falls short, then they go below anything else. So you may be entitled to get expectation damages. And what expectation damages means is to put the promisee in the position had the contract been performed. Okay, so that is something we can look at. So in terms of remedies, there are three: actual costs, then keep the benefit is retained, or expectation damages, put the promisee or the person who relied on the promise, who suffered the detriment, in a position had the contract been performed. All right, some points to note under reliance. I would like you to note, as per High Trees, you can reassert the original claim. Okay. Now, what that means in the case of High Trees, if anybody remember that case, and for those of you who don't, it was basically a situation where the landlord, due to war, had made a decision and promised to reduce the rent during wartime. When wartime ended, the tenant sought to claim that he could have continued paying the reduced rent. The court said no, the promise was only really just to during the period of war, and therefore the landlord was able to now recover the normal rent of its normal rate. So therefore, you can reassert in terms of points, and in terms of High Trees, you can reassert the original claim. Now, the other point to note that I want to mention is proprietary estoppel. Now, this is important because this is going to confuse you. Proprietary estoppel is the only estoppel that you can use as a sword. Please don't be confused. Just remember that. Now, what I mean by that is you can enforce an incomplete gift under proprietary estoppel. Proprietary estoppel really means, proprietary means interest in, and it is more specific to interest in land. So therefore, in a situation where you would have acted on in terms of there's a certain development that is supposed to happen on the land, instead of waiting for, you can enforce based on that proprietary estoppel, you can bring it as a claim to complete an incomplete gift. Okay, I just want to mention that to you. So understand, if you have, and I haven't honestly seen it, but just be aware that if you're having a discussion of land, you can have all the promissory estoppel discussion that we've just had, about sword and shield and all the requirements and the promise and the unjust and being unconscionable and all those, and talk about the remedies. But when it comes to LAN, the only side note you have is this would be seen as preparatory estoppel. And the difference is that it can be used as a sword, which means that you can now be the originator of a claim so that you could seek the remedy of completing an incomplete GIF. Okay? Now, the last note that I want you to be aware of is estoppel by convention. Now, this is a situation that normally is very common in an agency agreement. And the case I want you to see is Ryan v. Moore. Now, in terms of estoppel by convention, it usually lies in agency agreement where there is a set of facts that are made and a party runs off with those facts and probably acts on those facts. Because you have signed to those facts, you cannot act contrary to those facts. So the party that is relying on those facts made by an agreement that these facts are as they are, you cannot act contrary to those facts, or the party cannot act contrary to the facts. So you are estoppel by convention in terms of an agreement. This is very common in agency agreements. Now, I just want to recap the entire thing. I know reliance can tend to be a little bit much, particularly when you have to have the discussion together with consideration. I urge you to practice questions. And I like doing questions with students when they call. So therefore, what I'm going to do is just recap. So in reliance, we talked about representation. We talked about facts and future conducts. We then evolved into promises. We talked about how in the Hughes case, representation was kind of a being developed and pushed in and massaged in a way where promissory estoppel was developed. We reach into the position where the mother-in-law is saying they rather enforce a promise that is relied on rather than a representation. We talked about estoppel, where it came from an equitable remedy to now a common law doctrine. We talked about high trees and comb, where it was seen as a sword originally by Lord Denning, and then he came and said, no, I think it's a shield in comb. We talked about promissory estoppel. We talked about the requirements, which was a promise, a change in position, okay? A promise by the promise, a change in position by the promisee. We talked about it being unjust and unconscionable to recant on the promise. And we talked about the fact that the detriment suffered must, or the detriment that the promisee experience must be real. It must be actual. Okay, we talked about the remedies that were available, claim for actual damages, cost incurred, claim for the expectation damages as it relates to putting the party in the position, the promisee in a position had the contract been performed, and we talked about retaining the benefits. We also mentioned some discussion points. The discussion points, we talked about reasserting the claim. We mentioned the High Tree case. During the war, post-war, revert to the original tenant rate or rental rate. We talked about proprietary estoppel being the only estoppel, being the interest in land in which it could be used as a sword, because you can actually make a claim to complete an incomplete gift. And we talked about estoppel by convention as it relates to an agreement of facts, and you can't renege or recant on those facts because of the fact that you have agreed to those common facts, or those facts have agreed mutually by the parties. Now, that brings us to an end to reliance. So what, just to recap totally, criteria for enforcements or of enforcement, the four areas, common law grounds, reasons for enforcing promises, parties to a contract, formalities, and capacity to engage in a contract. We went into reasons for enforcing promises, the common law grounds. We talked about the subheadings under that, which included consideration, seal, and reliance. Now, that brings us to the end of that first subheading of that second limb. The next one, we will talk about the next subheading. Thanks for joining, and don't forget to subscribe, and don't forget to recommend the videos. Thank you.